Hello, my name is Jason Johnson, and thank you for watching my videos. Hope you find my videos helpful, and thank you for subscribing to my channel. If you have any questions or feedback, you can leave a comment below, and I'll answer as quick as possible, and I'll try to point you in the right direction. This video is going to cover NETACAD, the Cisco NETACAD IT Essentials, Chapter 10, Part 2 of 2, and this video is going to focus on Linux and the OS X operating system. So let's take a look at these two sections here, and then we're going to do a chapter summary. So we're going to take a look at Linux and the OS operating system, then we'll finish up with the basic troubleshooting process for mobile, Linux, and OS X and OS X operating systems, and then we'll do a chapter summary. So with the Linux operating system, I'm not going to go into the history and the background of Linux and the operating system and Linus Torvalds and all of the creation of the open source software and the open source community. I would recommend that you check out the description below. I've got some links there that will give you some history on Linux, and also check out the NETACAD course. It's going to have some more information on this for you for Linux. So with Linux, we're going to look at an introduction to the operating systems. Now, Linux and OS X, they're called cousins of each other, or they're related to each other in the fact that they both come from the Unix operating system, or the original Unix operating system. So both Linux and OS are Unix derivatives, or they inherited their traits, or they came from the Unix operating system. So both OSs keep most of the Unix basic traits, structure traits. In other words, they don't have things like Windows has, where you don't have drive letters like C and D and things like that. They're based on folders type of structure. Modern versions of Ubuntu Linux include Unity. Modern versions of OS X include Aqua. Unity and Aqua GUIs are similar UI elements. There are multiple different GUIs, or graphical user interfaces, that you can get with Linux. There's a couple of main ones, and then Ubuntu has Unity, but there are hundreds of different GUIs that you can get and put on there. You can get Linux, and you can create your own GUI with the open operating system if you want to get into some programming and change the GUI around on yourself. With the OS X, though, it's locked into what they call the Aqua GUI, but they do have some similar elements to them. Now, when we look at the overview of Linux and OS, or OS X, I'm just going to say OS X here, I guess is a good way to say it. But due to the relation to Unix, both Linux and OS X have similar command line interface, CLIs. The text-based tools, they have a shell. The file permissions and case sensitivity are a few common characteristics. Linux and our OS X is case sensitive, wherein over on the Windows side it's not, and they inherited that from the Unix. Now, when we look over at the backup and recovery on these, on the backup and recovery, it does allow the user to restore or recover the data in case of a failure. The Deja Dupe is an easy and efficient tool for backing up data in Linux. There's some other open source backup tools out there as well. OS X users can use Time Machine. It's a user-friendly, efficient backup tool. And they are very similar to each other because, again, they're based on a similar Unix operating system, which is now either Linux or OS X. Now, the overview of disk utilities. Modern operating systems do include disk tools to help troubleshoot and solve disk-related problems. Just like with Windows, both Linux and OS X have those as well. A lot of disk problems are the same regardless of the OS. So whether it's Windows, whether it's Linux or OS X, some of the disk problems are going to be similar. So those tools are going to be similar that fix those. A good disk tool that should be provided or should be, let me restate that. A good disk tool should be able to provide partition management, mounting and unmounting of disk partitions, formatting, bad sector checks, and smart queries. And disk and disk utilities are disk tools included in both Linux and OS X. So to install and boot more than one OS, though, a boot manager is required. Grub is on the Linux side. Grub does allow you to boot multiple operating systems, either multiple Linux systems or a Linux and a Windows system. And then Bootcamp is a popular boot manager for Linux and OS as well. Now, when we look at scheduling tasks in the systems here, maintenance tasks should be scheduled and performed frequently. Computer systems can be programmed to perform tasks automatically, such as backups and disk checks. Those are some good examples of frequent tasks. The cron service on Linux can be used to schedule tasks in Linux and OS X. And then with security, measures can and should be taken to prevent malicious software from getting into a mobile computer system or into the Linux or the OS X as well. Now, there is some misconception about OS X and Linux that viruses do not get in those operating systems, that they're safe, quote-unquote safe, because they don't get viruses as often. The thought on that, and this is my personal opinion, is that those operating systems do not have as many viruses on them is because they are not used as much. The Windows platform has by far the most users in the IT operating area. And so the people that are writing the viruses are going to go for the low-hanging fruit. And they're going to write viruses for platforms that have 70 to 75% of the market and not that 20%, because they don't reap the same rewards from a smaller market. And that's why Windows has many more viruses that are out there. Now, there can also be some arguments about safety and some things like that versus, you know, Linux and OS X versus Windows. I'm not going to get into that because I don't really take sides. I teach all the operating systems equally. And so you can look at different aspects of that about, you know, which ones are more safe or which ones are more secure. What I'm going to tell you is, you're never truly safe and secure with your operating system, so you need to take measures to secure yourself. So those include making sure your OS is always updated, make sure that your firmware has the latest updates, make sure that you're running antivirus and anti-malware, and you can run those both on the Linux and the OS X as well. I'm not going to go into the video on here on which software, because that information gets dated, but you can check, depending upon your operating system, which one to run on there versus the Windows. Now, when we look at file and folder commands, those are similar between the two operating systems. A number of command line tools are included in the Unix-like systems by default. Some common ones are ls, like list, cd, change directory, cp for copy, mv for move. You've got the grep command. Some administrative commands that you have. Unix and the derivatives utilize file permissions to create boundaries within the system. And that's one of the more secure ways that Linux and OS X operates, is that it's based on file permissions. Now, every file on Unix carries its own file permissions. So Unix file permissions can be read, write, or execute, or a combination of those. So a user can have access to those. So you would have flags on those, like read, write, the user would have these boundaries here, and they would be given flags of, can the user read this, can it write to it, or can it execute that file? If it has read, it can just pull that file up and look at it. The user has write, it can make changes to that, or X for execute, it can actually execute that a program or execute some type of a file from there. If a user is inside of a group, does the group have access to this? And then there's other out here. Now, also keep in mind that if a user is within a group, it's going to inherit those permissions. So if user is in group A, and group A is given permission for read, then user 1 is going to inherit the rights from group A and also have a read permission. So users inherit rights from the groups, just as a side note there for you. Now let's take a look at basic troubleshooting processes for mobile Linux and operating system, OS X operating systems. These are very similar to what we've been covering in the class all along. You want to identify the problem, ask open-ended questions. You want to establish your theory of probable cause. I'm going to go through these rather quickly, by the way, because we keep going over these each chapter and reinforcing these. You want to make sure that you establish your theory of probable cause, test that theory to determine if that is truly the cause, then establish your plan of action, resolve the problem, implement the solution, verify that the system is fully functional, and implement preventative measures, and then document. Document all your findings on there. Okay, so identifying common problems and solutions with operating systems. Computer problems can be attributed to hardware, software, networks, or a combination of any of those three. So you always want to use Occam's razor, and you can look up Occam's razor on the internet if you want to, but Occam's razor is the simplest answer is going to be, should be the correct answer. That's the way I kind of use Occam's razor in this instance. The simplest answer is most likely going to be the correct answer. So many problems can be solved with a reboot. That's true about Windows, Linux, or OS X. Sometimes just rebooting refreshes memory, it refreshes the operating system, and sometimes that just fixes a lot of things. When a mobile device does not respond to a reboot, a reset may be performed. You may have to go into a factory reset. In the case of mobile devices, it's really nice whether you have an Apple device or a Linux or an Android device or a Windows device. When you reset that device, and then all of your information can then just be reloaded back down based upon your logins. So, you know, like on an Android, you would just go back into the Google Play Store and all your apps, once you log in, all your apps would just roll back down to that device. Same thing with the iPhones. So then when a standard reset does not correct the problem, a factory reset may need to be performed. And then when a reboot does not fix a PC, then you have to go further. So just rebooting it, still having the same problems, then you just keep going farther. But you always want to do the simple things first. So that's just one of the things when I did help desk. My users, when I would go to help them, their first response would be, yes, I've already rebooted, because they knew that was the question I was going to ask them. Have you rebooted yet? Because if you haven't rebooted, let's do that first. So some configuration could be changed. Software could have been updated, and that's some of the simple questions that you would ask. You know, what was loaded last? Did something update? What did you open an email? What websites did you go to? Things like that. You know, the simple questions. Start investigating and figuring out what caused the problem and what needs to be reinstalled or fixed. Okay, so with Chapter 10, Parts 1 and 2, we looked at mobile devices. We covered mobile devices, the operating systems used on mobile devices. We also looked at Ubuntu, Linux, and Apple. And I just want to say that this chapter in no way covers even close to all of the information that you can learn about Linux or the Apple operating system. There is much, much more that you'll learn about those, but this is just an overview for the A Plus and for the Cisco NETACAD course. We did learn about graphical user interfaces, or the GUI, and some of the tools that are used. We also learned about troubleshooting the mobile operating systems, Linux, and the OS X. Now, some things to remember that are important from this chapter. Android devices use apps to synchronize data, not automatically synchronized by Google. iOS devices use iTunes to synchronize data. Passcode locks can secure mobile devices, and they can and should be used. Remote backups can be performed to a mobile device, data to the cloud. You should also turn on device tracking. I just had an example this weekend where I lost my I've got a Galaxy Tab 2 Android device, and I lost it. I didn't know where it was. And so I went on to the tracking, tracked it, and it was showing at my house. And I had remembered that I had left it in my car. So I went out to my car in the garage, and sure enough, it was down in beside the seat where I had left it 2 days earlier, and forgot about it, and then couldn't find it, couldn't remember where I left it. And then, but my tracking, my went on to you know, the Google website, and it was tracking it down, and it said, hey, it just connected today. It showed me that it was just on the network, and that it showed me that which address it was at, and I was able to find it quickly. So you should also be able to can and should set remote locks up and remote wipes where you can, if a device gets stolen or lost, you can wipe that device. A lot of companies do force that down on a device. And then you also want to look at antivirus software. It is sometimes used on mobile devices to prevent the transfer of malicious programs to other devices or computers. I will tell you personally, my opinion is if you watch your device close enough, you don't really necessarily need antivirus, but you want to watch out what apps you're putting on there and what websites you're going to, so that you can be careful about those. Okay, well, that is Chapter 10, Part 2 of 2. I hope this video was helpful for you, and thank you for subscribing, and I hope you have a great day.